here. Why don't we just start at this side, we'll go around the block, and then we'll have Andy up. Andy, Chief Executive Editor of Christianity Today, author, passionate about social justice and that, and brings a good work on the whole mix and life of work and faith. And so we are on loan for him, with him for a little bit, because Deuce has him for the whole weekend there and that. But if you need to give us a call to get out of that youth thing, just let us know. We get too tough down there.
No way.
Yeah. I'm Justin Domino. I'm the youth pastor here at New Hope, and this church is pretty rural. You guys know where it is.
I'm Deuce. I'm the high school youth pastor over at First, and also Andy's handler this weekend.
Joel Goff, interim at Elam in the heart of downtown IC.
The heart, nice.
I'm Beth Pettit. I'm the connections director right here at New Hope.
And I'm Bryce Harsey, executive pastor here at New Hope.
Travis Blake, the lead pastor at North IC Baptist Church, right off the South Play.
Hey everyone, my name is Kelly Larson, and I'm a ministry assistant here at New Hope.
I am Lisa McCarthy, and I'm the pastor of Children's and Families here at New Hope.
Andy Bromstead, Cambridge Lutheran pastor, we're very urban.
John Patterson, Cambridge Lutheran associate pastor.
Terry Port, pastor of Assimilation Life Groups at First Baptist. And I was going to say, Andy, you mentioned this morning that youth were at the top of your list. Hopefully, if we're at the bottom of your list, you don't articulate that.
Awesome. Jared Gustafson, and I'm the lead pastor at First Baptist, and we're in the heart of old downtown Cambridge. There's a debate now what the true downtown is, but yeah, old downtown, that's where we exist, yeah.
Jean Rollin, pastor at Common Ground United Methodist Community, middle of Cambridge between schools.
Don't know what it is.
Gary Tun from Carmel Covenant Church, rural. You're welcome to come to our facility next month, for the meeting. We're a lighthouse to the Scandinavian people of our area.
What a calling.
It is.
Steve Lubu, pastor of Emeritus Lakeside Church. I already am a bigger, better vision of faith and work.
Aaron Newton, pastor of Lakeside Church, which is right over here on Fanny Lake. And our attendance goes up in the wintertime when the fish houses are
open. Can you count those? Yeah. Cool. Well, Bill Burton, New Hope right here. Again, thanks for being with us. It's awesome. I'm going to hand it over to Andy.
All right.
Thank you.
Let me see if I remember your names. I think I remember them. Ooh. Justin. Deuce, I just learned. Not Jared. I've been being too formal with you. Now you're Deuce. Joel, Beth, Bryce, Travis, Kelly, Lisa, Andy, John, Terry, Jared, Jean, Gary, Steve, Aaron, and Bill.
Wow.
Yeah. All right.
You've got great eyesight.
Yeah, exactly. No, I was not reading your name tags. Well, I try to listen and learn people's names because at a very important moment in your life, someone, usually two someones, thought a lot about what to name you, and they made that choice with much deliberation and joy, so I try to pay attention. So it's great to meet you all. I'm Andy. I have the great fun of getting to travel a lot and try to pay attention to what's happening in the church, especially in North America, to some extent around the world. And I try to come as a journalist everywhere I go, and part of what journalists do is we just try to listen well and then try to integrate what we see and hear into bigger trends. And one of the things that has been clear to me is we're actually at a moment of great opportunity to rethink how our churches pastor people in the area of work, their daily work, especially their paid work. And also to be aware of ways that we haven't always done this well. And so I've been thinking a lot about it over the last few years. We just produced a curriculum at CT that's called Redeeming Work, where we actually did several, about 10, I think, short documentary videos of people at work. So we have a furniture maker, we have an auto mechanic, we have a urban gardener who helps, she helps urban kids learn to garden. And then we kind of wrap that in some more theological and pastoral content about how to think about all the different dimensions of our work. And to set up why I think this is an issue, I want to tell you two stories, one of which at least Terry heard this morning at the breakfast that we did. I'll start with that one. Just 2 weeks ago, I was in Dallas at a big Christian meeting, and one of the people who was speaking runs a religious liberty law firm. They take on cases where often, an awful lot of religious liberty cases are so clear in retrospect. It's like it's just someone who doesn't know how much freedom our Constitution grants to all kinds of religious organizations, not just Christians. And so, but somebody has to come along when, say, a school administrator just makes a poor decision or an uninformed decision, and sometimes you have to litigate that. So this guy had this kind of firm that worked on these issues. These are very important issues. And he would recruit senior experienced litigating attorneys to donate their time pro bono to these cases, because it's not usually really a financial reward, so you have to do it as a volunteer. And he described how thrilled these very accomplished attorneys were to work with his organization. And he said this actually two times in his presentation. He said, when I meet with these attorneys and give them the chance to take on one of these pro bono cases, he says that, he said, they often tell me, this is the first time in my whole legal career that I've done something for the kingdom. Now, he presented it, and I think I can understand why he saw it this way, as a very heartwarming thing. Like, he's giving these folks finally an opportunity to do law in a meaningful way. What I heard was, what are you doing the rest of your legal career? And why? And you know, he talked about one guy who had been practicing law for 30 years and said, this is the first time I've been able to practice law for God. So the question comes, who were you practicing law for the previous 30 years of your career? And then the further question that I ask is, where are the pastors of those lawyers? And what are the churches telling them such that they believe that they've been going to work every day, often long hours in the law, day after day, week after week, year after year, and somehow they've gotten the message from their church that what they're doing is not for God, doesn't intersect with the kingdom of God, and that the only way it might intersect is if they could find some way to leverage their position and their experience to do something that actually could never pay their bills, is not their main legal specialty, but that they can kind of do on the side. How is it that we've ended up with that picture? There's another story that I think may shed a little more light on it from a book called Church on Sunday, Work on Monday, which was written by Scotty McLennan and Laura Nash a number of years ago now. It was one of the first books that really tried to tackle faith and work issues. And they tell a story of a group of seminary students who watch a short video, maybe a little bit like the ones that we've produced for the series we did. But this happened to be a video of a guy who was working at a gas station in Florida at the time of an evacuation for a hurricane, and he was keeping the gas station open so that as people were, you know, taking the evacuation route, they could fill up their cars. And then they just had an open-ended discussion with these seminarians about what they saw in the video. And what emerged is that what the seminarians saw was very different from what was actually in the video. The first direction the conversation went, they observed that this man was African American. And they said, this black man is being exploited by his employers and made to work and keep open the station when he should be protecting himself and getting out like everyone else is. Why are his employers making him keep the gas station open? So they saw it as a kind of labor exploitation story. They had missed in the video the fact that this was actually the owner of the gas station. Mm-hmm. So they assumed that he was an employee. He actually was the owner. And then the next misinterpretation is they said, well, okay, maybe he's the owner, but he's probably raising his prices to gouge, you know, sort of take this commercial opportunity to make a lot of money. When in fact, in the video, the guy had said he was not raising his prices. So here's someone who is proudly serving his neighbors through the business he owns, and a group of seminary students watch it, and what they assume they're seeing is either exploitation of the worker or exploitation of the customer. And I'm not going to say this represents all seminary students or all future pastors.
I think I was in that class.
But, you know, I started to listen in my own church. So we attend a church that has served our family very well on the whole. But I started to listen to the preaching in our church, and especially for moments when it touched on any kind of vocation outside of the church. And I actually started to notice our pastors, who are wonderful men and women and wonderful preachers on the whole, but every reference to work that they made over the next few years as I was kind of actively paying attention was in some way tinged with negativity. It was somehow about damaging competition or greed or how long you have to work, you know, and how demanding work is. And there was this one moment in a sermon one week where our senior pastor started talking about, I forget exactly what this guy, I think he might have been a dentist, or he ran a small professional practice of some kind. And our pastor in the sermon started to describe how this member of our congregation was sort of faithful in his business, paid his workers well, had grown this business, and I thought, oh my gosh, the streak's about to end. Like, I'm actually hearing a positive story of faithful business. And the punchline was, and now it's so exciting that our brother is selling his business and going into missionary work in Bolivia. So the whole setup was, and now he's doing really important things. And I think, unfortunately, this is not unrepresentative of how we tend to present the world of work as leaders in the church. And part of it, I think, is that we depend in all Christian ministries to a great extent on volunteer labor. That is, we depend on people finding some uncompensated reason to invest actually their work. I mean, a lot of what you have to do to keep any church going is work. But we depend on people to give themselves, just like we depend on them to give their money. And inevitably, in order to motivate volunteering, it's very tempting to present what you are asking people to do as a higher calling, right? Because that can motivate people. And then, in order to present as a higher calling, it's very tempting to present the work they do day to day as a lower calling. So that sometimes I think inadvertently, like, I don't think if I sat down with our senior pastor and said, do you really believe that what that member of our church was doing before he went to Bolivia was not serving God? I don't think he would believe that. But it's deployed rhetorically to motivate people to a certain kind of service that we're afraid people won't be motivated to otherwise. And then when I got more cynical, and I look at my own temptation, especially when I was in campus ministry, where I was working with college students, where we're trying to persuade them to come to Bible study, get involved in our summer mission trip, whatever. Sometimes when I'm a little more cynical, I think, I wonder if we're sometimes tempted to make the world look worse than it is, so we can make the church look better than it is. In other words, to exaggerate the extent to which sin has infected that terrible world so that we can invite people into the wonderful experience of serving in our nursery or teaching in our Sunday school or being a member of our Bible study. So this sent me on a quest that I was feeling when I was in campus ministry. I really was feeling like I do not know how to account for the good work students are doing in the 4 years they're in college. Our fellowship was, I think, very good at three things. There were three things we were able to call students to. We were able to call them to a kind of personal life of devotion and prayer. And we had good ways of teaching people to build a relationship with God in those first few years out of their home, out of their family's home, out of their home church. And then we were able to call them to community with one another. And we were able to call that community, in turn, to service. We really emphasized, I worked at Harvard University, you might have heard of it, a little school in Boston, and I think we really learned how to call Harvard students, who can be very self-absorbed, to a mission beyond just their own career and their own advancement. But towards the end of my 10 years working there, I started to wrestle with this question. I thought, okay, you can have a vibrant personal life of prayer and devotion to God. You can be part of a thriving Christian community, and you can be giving your life away in service. And in order to do those three things, you do not have to be a student at Harvard. Like, why wouldn't we just call them all to quit and stop doing that and just do those three things full time? And especially since every student at Harvard is doing the equivalent of totaling an SUV every year economically. That's how I think of college tuition. It's like a really, these days, really nice SUV every year. Crash, crash, 4 years worth. Like huge amounts of resources are being spent on them having time in the library, time in the lab, the work of a student. And we honestly had very little to offer them from a Christian framework to help them understand what they were doing in their actual work, the actual thing that someone was paying a lot of money for them to get to do. And I just felt like this isn't right. I don't actually think they should all leave. So what do I think I would offer them? Here's where I've ended up, and I'm gonna give you, I'm gonna take like 17 more minutes. I'm tracking this, and then I'll stop and we'll talk about whatever you wanna talk about. But in 17 minutes, I wanna give you just a window into how I've started to think about this. And the wonderful thing is what I feel like I've discovered is actually as we go back and we start to ask, how can the church see work as an arena for faithfulness and for discipleship, which I think is really the crux of it. The question is, do we see daily work as a place where you can be faithful? Unlike those seminary students who thought, well, there's no way for that gas station worker owner to be faithful there. And then do we see it as a crucible of discipleship, that this is a place where you actually can come closer to being formed into the image of Christ? What is the what's the framework that could help us understand that? As we ask that question, I think we actually discover dimensions of the biblical story and ultimately the gospel that we've been missing. So we actually end up in no way giving up the unique vocation of the church to induct people into this story of the people of God and tell them the good news. We don't give that up at all. In fact, it becomes much more meaningful as you integrate it with what people do in a lot of their lives. One more preface to this, just a really interesting historical kind of comparison. There's another arena that people invest a lot of their lives in that's outside the direct control of the pastor or the church that we actually have no trouble seeing as an arena of faithfulness, an arena of discipleship, even though it doesn't happen in the walls of the church and the church doesn't control it. And that's life in the home and the life of the family. And the interesting thing is, for much of church history, the church in any direct way did very little to support people in their vocations as fathers, mothers, children, brothers and sisters, aunts, uncles. I mean, it probably happened indirectly, but there weren't targeted family ministries. And now, many of our churches devote a huge amount of resources to saying, directly and indirectly, to especially say to parents, what you are doing is of tremendous importance for the gospel. We're here to help you. We're here to provide you all kinds of training and support and community as you do this very difficult thing of kind of sustaining, forming and sustaining a family. We now do that in very intentional ways. We often have people on our staff who do that. Could it be, and that basically, if you look historically, that emerged around the turn of the 20th century. Before that, there is no family ministry of the kind that we have now. And one thing I wonder is, in another 100 years, I wonder if it will just be taken for granted that every church has deeply well-developed ways of supporting people in their work lives, just as much as we support them in their family lives. Because right now, if you go to church, you hear a lot about how to be faithful in the family. You hear almost nothing about how to be faithful at work. So, is it okay if I keep going for now 15 more minutes? All right. So, there's a lot of different ways to approach this, and actually, there's this amazing new commentary on the whole of Scripture. I'm blanking on the name of it. That goes through every book of the Bible and sort of unearths themes of faith and work in it. When I remember it, I'll tell you the name. And it's amazing what they find. You can find this anywhere. But I do think a wonderful foundational place to go is Genesis 1, 2, 3, because those give us the orienting story that's meant to animate the whole rest of the biblical story. So the climax of Genesis 1 is Genesis 1:26, where in this surprising kind of what I call the bonus round of creation, when on day 6 God has already filled the earth with creatures, but he creates these additional special creatures in his image. In the image of God he created them, male and female he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it, have dominion over everything else. This is essentially, we all know this, right? It's kind of the commission to work, but it's also the commission to bear the image of God. And this idea that our work is first of all about image bearing seems to me like the right place to begin. that when we do good work in the world, actually whether it's paid or unpaid doesn't really matter, but including paid work, when we do it well, we image God. And this morning I presented three ways we do that, and I'm just going to sketch them for you. I won't have time to go into them in much detail, but from Genesis 1, we get this interesting picture of God ordering the world. So days 1, 2, 3 of creation are essentially binary structurings, light and dark, heavens and earth, sea and land. It's just the creation of a kind of structure or order to creation. And then we get God filling the realm. So day 4, God fills the dark world with light, sun, moon, and stars. Day 5, God fills the heavens with birds and the sea with fish. And then day 6, God fills the land that has now been separated from the ocean, fills the land with creatures. So, and there's this wonderful word in Genesis 1 that's translated either swarming or teeming, which is, it's like the, it's not the opposite of order, it's the abundance that comes within order. And so God doesn't want just a machine world. God wants actually a world that has order to it, but then is full of all this unpredictable variety, all the different species of beetles and birds and fish and trees, and all that is meant to come in this ordered creation. And so you can plot this on a 2x2 and say the more ordering you have and the more teeming you have, or another word I like to use is abundance, the more you have a biblical cosmos, that is a biblical world, universe, that reflects the Creator's intention. And if you have order without abundance, that's just a machine, right? A machine is something that's always very well ordered, but never produces anything unpredictable or abundant. If you have abundance without order, I said this morning that you have my daughter's, my 15-year-old daughter's room, which is basically chaos down here. And you know, if you have no structure, you have the opposite of a machine, which is a completely chaotic environment, not a very fruitful environment for life, I keep trying to explain to my daughter. And if you have neither one, you actually have the nihilo, the nothing out of which the world is created, if you have neither structure nor abundance. What human beings do in all of their working of the world, including their tilling and tending of the world, responding to the Creator's command, is actually to further order the world. That is, they apply more dimensions of order. So we've taken this space, which was a wild space at some point, and an architect has created a structure. So there's a very kind of regular pattern to the beams here. We've created a perfectly rectangular room. This doesn't exist in nature, right? You know, human beings have been somewhere where you see kind of ordered pattern, that there is order in nature, but it doesn't look like this. But then what happens in this room, if it's well designed and human beings do their job, is actually all kinds of abundance can happen in this room that couldn't happen out in the yard. This is why when students say to their professors at the college where my wife teaches, or even in high school, sometimes you do this, students say, can we go outside to have class? If you've ever actually done that, it's a terrible idea. it totally does not work. Because you actually need the structure of a classroom or the structure of a room like this. And things can happen in here that can't happen otherwise, and flourishing happens in here that doesn't happen otherwise. So human beings actually further order the world, and then as they do that, they uncover all kinds of abundance and possibility in the world that wasn't obvious before. The most amazing being in the last 150 years or so, how we've discovered how much energy is locked in the chemical bonds of certain substances that we're able to liberate and thus power lights, power transportation, power new dimensions of connection between people. All that abundance was there all along, but it wasn't until people structured it that they found, oh my gosh, this world has even more capacity. And then we now know we have to figure out how to do this in a safe way, but that beyond the chemical bonds, if we can order and structure the nuclear bonds, there's more power locked up in a single atom than any conventional fossil fuel-based power plant can exploit. All that's there waiting for the image bearers to faithfully tend. So in a way, what you get, if it's not too strange to say this, is that as human beings further order the world and as they fill it with abundance, you get all the fruits of human culture at its best. And this is what work is. It's about bringing order and structure to human activity and then discovering that that is productive. That actually leads to all kinds of flourishing that wasn't there before. So Genesis 2, I'm going to do smaller because I'm only going to spend a second on it, but talks about the plants of the garden and actually also the minerals outside the garden, the gold, bdellium, and onyx that are outside the garden. And it describes the trees with this interesting phrase, they were good for food and a delight to the eyes. And what I like about that is it combines utility and beauty. So the garden, which is itself an ordered, abundant environment, a garden is a place where some creative intelligence has applied more order to natural plants, and thus there's a kind of abundance that isn't present in the wild. The garden also is this beautiful intersection of utility and beauty. In fact, we can call that garden, is kind of up and to the right on that, where things are both useful and pleasing. And good work always has this quality that it both creates something useful for human life and flourishing, but it's never merely useful. Good work, I think, I would suggest, in the image of God, always has this quality of beauty as well. The tragedy of the modern era of work, which began with the Industrial Revolution, is that it tried to turn work essentially into machines that had utilitarian outcomes. And so the factory system of production, which basically created much larger scale machines than human beings had ever thought to build before, which were very effective at producing certain kinds of goods, the problem was you had to fit people into those very large scale machines, and people became just a cog in a machine. And so when you think about the highly repetitive work that is now being replaced by robots, but the hundreds of years of asking human beings made in the image of God to act like a machine and not be able to fill and team and swarm in the way we're meant to, that was a tragedy of work. And what it produced was a culture that often becomes very utilitarian, settles for mere usefulness, even ugliness if it has to be. And then the reaction to that, by the way, is a kind of, you could call it romanticism or sentimentality, in which we settle actually for forms of art that are very, just sort of very pleasing, but they're actually not that useful, they don't go that deep, but it's actually a reaction to a world that's so machine-like that people just go for kind of cheap pleasures. So the second component of work in the image of God, not only is it ordering with abundance, it's utility with beauty. And you can ask this about any domain of work. You can even ask it, I mean, a gas station is a good limiting case. Gas stations are not where most people want to hang out. But if you have noticed, in the last 10 years or so, I've noticed gas stations have gotten more beautiful. Like they're taking more care to actually shape the space, often a certain amount of landscaping, design in terms of the canopies, and even the pumps. I mean, this is about as utilitarian as you can get. Filling your car up with gas, but someone's realized it's actually better to make this a human space that's a welcoming space. And there are ways that we could make it much more so. So our family has decided to have this discipline of saying grace at the gas pump, because we figure we do this at every meal. We thank God for the food while we're feeding our car, in a sense. And why do we say grace? Because we have this sense that we have this unearned gift. Well, what is oil and gas, if not a completely unearned gift in one sense, like it's been there for millions of years, and we now can use that coiled energy for whatever we like, and why would we not pause? So after we fill it up, someone in the car in the family just says a short prayer saying, thank you, God, for this gas. May we use it faithfully, keep us safe as we drive. And that actually is a way of adding a sense of appreciation of, in a way, the beauty of what we're able to do because of this very useful thing to our family's life. So one last picture of image bearing, and then I want to talk about the other component of this. And it kind of comes out of Genesis 3, though it's really Genesis 2 and 3. And that is what, to me, is the most interesting pairing of all three of these. And that is two qualities the image bearers have more than any other creature that God makes. And that is authority and vulnerability. The interesting thing about the human beings that God makes is they have more authority than any other creature. That is, they're able to act with more effect and scope. I define authority as capacity for meaningful action. And we human beings, even though in one sense we're very like other animals in many ways, we are completely unlike them in how widely and powerfully we're able to act in the world. We have more authority than any other creature. And at the same time, human beings, in many ways, have more vulnerability than any other creature. So I'm staying with Deuce and his wife last night, and they have a 10-month-old, still 10 months. And it's a reminder, there is no creature that is dependent on its family as long as a human being. I mean, a baby lamb is born, and within, I don't know, an hour, the lamb off is up and walking, right? And nurses for a month or two, and then is off eating grass. Whereas we human beings for years, like these days with the extension of adolescence, it's like well into your 30s, right? So, right? So we are dependent, which being to be dependent is to be vulnerable. And then there's this amazing symbolism of it, by the way, in the in Genesis 2, or well, Genesis 3, where it says the man and his wife were naked, though without shame. And nakedness is a way of saying vulnerability. That's and no other creature has that. Like, we don't look at any other creature and think, oh, it's not properly clothed. When the lamb is born, you don't look at it and think, oh, you know, wait till it puts something on, a naked lamb. No, it's got everything it needs. But we human beings live our whole lives with the reality that without clothing, we are vulnerable to the environment and to each other. People have pointed out to me, there's this thing called the naked mole rat. So they say, well, there's one other creature that is, okay, there's one other creature that we call naked. But it's the exception that proves the rule. It's just not something other creatures have. So the interesting thing is, if you want to be an image bearer, you have to have high authority and high vulnerability, I would say. And when I do this with the kids tomorrow morning, actually, I'll go into this in much greater depth. Like, this is what it is to be a human being. So the thing is, that feels scary, because where would you rather be in this little chart, rather than up and to the right? Wouldn't it be awesome if you could have authority without vulnerability? And this gets to the next theme. So the first theme is image bearing, work as image bearing. Good work gives people both capacity for action and exposes them to meaningful risk. That's my definition of vulnerability, exposure to meaningful risk. But what's offered in Genesis 3 to the man and the woman is, if you eat this fruit, which God has told you not to eat, you will be like God, knowing good and evil, and you shall not surely die. Which happen to be promises of total authority and minimal or no vulnerability. And that is the promise, not just of the fruit or the serpent, but I would say the best word for it is that's the promise of idolatry. So idolatry promises you authority without vulnerability. Every idol says, if you orient your life around me, you'll have all the capacity you want with none of the risk that you fear. Bill and I were talking about how this church serves people in recovery, and addiction is a very clear example of this, where any addictive substance, and human beings are so creative we can get addicted to almost anything, promises you, like you think about what happens when you start to enter into an addictive relationship, say with alcohol. Your first few times you drink to excess, you will feel this kind of elevated sense of power, control, and a minimized sense of vulnerability. And people often drink to minimize their sense of anxiety. The problem is the idols don't keep working. They actually do work at first, but they don't keep working. And the thing that started out promising you authority without vulnerability eventually leads you all the way to the other end. And my word for this corner is poverty. I think the essence of poverty is to have vulnerability without authority. The things that promise us authority without vulnerability end up making us vulnerable without authority. And then there's a corollary to this. There are two things that the prophets in the Hebrew Bible are constantly bringing God's judgment on. One is idol worship, these false gods that promise this life without vulnerability. The other thing, of course, that they speak against is injustice. And injustice is just a social system where some people get to have authority without vulnerability at the cost of many other people in the system living in poverty, vulnerability without authority. I've used up the 30 minutes I promised. I'll take like one more minute to try to land this plane and then we can talk. Here's how I apply this to work. What work is meant to be, and through common grace and God's kind of gracious preservation of the world and the influence of the church, I would say, work can still be that. It's meant to be ordering with abundance, usefulness with beauty, and authority with vulnerability. And when you think about your best work experiences, I bet you'll realize they had all these qualities. But, of course, Act 2 in the biblical story is that we exchanged all that. We image bearers made this bargain with idols and injustice. And now all work, including work in the church, is tinged with these two things. And we use our positions as pastors to insulate us from vulnerability. Or other people want their pastor to use their position to do that. And that generates a lot of people. So a few people get to benefit from this for a while in any given system, while many other people are stuck with no ability to bear the image of God. And the work they do is demeaning, degrading, even profoundly exploitative, because we've ended up on this axis rather than on this axis. And that leads to the third theme, which I'll just state and then I'll stop. We were meant to be image bearers. We've really become image breakers in a way. The image of God is no longer flourishing in the world. And this leads to the whole rest of the Bible, which is the calling of a people, first Israel in the Old Testament, then the people of God, the new Israel in the New Testament, who will restore the image of God in the world. And of course, the hinge of this is the arrival in the story. When the time had fully come, God sent his own Son, who is all authority and all vulnerability. Who ever taught like Jesus? Who ever acted like Jesus? But whoever suffered like Jesus? And he now commissions us to go out and restore his image in the world. So the question for work that we can ask everybody we meet is, how are you bearing the image? How are you ordering and bringing abundance? How are you bringing utility and beauty? How are you experiencing authority and vulnerability? And then you can ask, how's the image broken in the place where you work? And there is always an answer to that question. And then the distinct mission of the church, we have been entrusted with the task of restoring the image, finding ways to intervene in every sector of society such that true image bearing becomes a possibility again. I think that gives us a lot to talk about with people about their law firm and their gas station. And it makes you realize this is all about the mission of God, the big story of God in the world. So that's my little framework for thinking about it. I'd love to have some conversation about what that's provoked for you. Yeah, Gene.
What do you put in the fourth quadrant?
Oh, yeah. So I did this. This is my next book is this about this chart, and I've been presenting it all over. I was in Haiti with some pastors in Haiti, seminary students and pastors, and we were working our way through, and they said, no one can live down here with neither authority nor vulnerability. And I said, oh yes you can if you live in America. Because what I would call this lower quadrant is safety. And safety is the condition where you can retreat from action, so you don't have to take authority, and you can retreat from risk. And if you're sufficiently affluent and powerful, that's an option that you have. So you move into a gated community. You might start a business that goes really well, sell all of it, and then you live off the income, and now you're not even taking the risk of running a business. You're not even investing it. You're living down here. And this is also like, this is kind of your parents' basement in a way. Like video games in the basement, I think, is a great way to stay disengaged from the world.
Isn't that the American dream? Yeah. I mean, could it be
totally.
Retirement?
Totally. This is why retirement is not, I mean, the way we've conceived of it, we have this, see, what the biblical idea is sabbatical. So the biblical idea is every seventh year, the land and the people rest. But the American dream is retirement, which is you work your whole life, and then when you're completely exhausted, then you have rest, with no remaining authority. And that is not, I think that's a very broken model of what rest is supposed to be for people. Not that there's not a stage in life where you stop doing economic work and so forth. But yeah, to the extent that retirement ends up down here, it's like the opposite of being human in a way. Yeah, which is why it's so hard for people often.
Mm-hmm. I was in a Bible study yesterday. We were looking at Hebrews and talking about rest.
Yeah.
And somebody asked, when do we get that? I said, when we get to heaven.
Right.
Not until.
Right. Right. Sabbath in now, I mean, there remains a Sabbath rest. That's kind of the grand celebration at the end of it all. But now it's a rhythm. It's meant to be a rhythm. And it's a preparation to go back out and take authority and vulnerability. rather than just a retreat or an endless vacation. When I show this to the kids tomorrow, I'm going to put up a picture of a cruise ship. I think a cruise is kind of, going on a cruise is kind of people's dream of, I won't have to do anything, just lie around, all the food's there. And that's great for 3 days. It would be hell for 3 years, right? It's not where we're meant to live.
That's a paradigm shift.
All right. Yep. Other thoughts?
What? So out of those three, where do you think the major breakdown is as far as within the church or within the Christ followers' identity?
Of the three, the three two-by-twos?
Which one seems to be the very first one that just...
Right.
That's the biggest breakdown, so you can't get through the rest.
The kind of the way we're given the story, I think, gives us a clue. I think it's really this one. The hinge is this condition of having authority with vulnerability is so unstable and so threatening, even though it's also so good. I mean, it's what we're meant to be. But the human choice to opt out of that and go for authority without vulnerability, it actually then goes back and infects these other things. So now, once people are pursuing authority without vulnerability, that affects the economies they build, the industries they reward, and you start getting utilitarianism. And then we really get into gear in the modern era, which is the height of the kind of worship of control, of culture as control. Francis Bacon, 400 years ago, had this vision. If we could figure out how the world works, we'd be able to control it like a machine and get it to do it exactly what we want to do. Profoundly unbiblical idea of what human beings are here for. He had this vision. We're here to master the world in a very dominating way. And, well, as it turns out, we were kind of able to do that. Like, we found out enough about the way the world works at the level of physics and chemistry that we were able to do it. But what it ends up doing is totally throwing off what the kind of order and beauty we're meant to bring in the world. So I would say it traces back to this human choice to essentially to worship idols, worship false gods, and attempt to be false gods. Yeah.
Well, kind of with the whole domination, doesn't it really go back to that misinterpretation of the Hebrew word domination?
Yes.
Instead of stewardship.
Dominion. Yes.
Custodian.
Yes. Exactly.
Because if we retake, we are custodians, not
exactly.
Dominators.
Exactly. Yes.
That flips it.
And one of the things that is so striking to me is the original readers of that text, and of course it's recapitulated in Psalm 8, right? Psalm 8 is really interesting because it both talks about vulnerability. When I look at the heavens and the stars and the work of your hands, what am I, a human being, that you even notice me? There's a tremendous sense of vulnerability in the natural world for ancient peoples. And at the same time it says, but you have made human beings a little lower than the angels, crowned them with glory and honor, and given them dominion over the works of your hand. And then the psalmist enumerates the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, and everything that creeps along the land, something like that. Now the fascinating thing is, how could an ancient Hebrew dominate the fish of the sea or the birds of the air? Like, it would have been inconceivable to them that you could somehow master or control those domains. Like, the birds fly wherever they want. We can't fly. Maybe you shoot one down out of 100. The fish, especially for Israel, Israel is not a seafaring nation, if you've noticed in the Bible. Like, the Phoenicians go there. The people from up the coast go there. We don't go there. But this is an Israelite saying human beings have been given dominion over this realm that we can't even fathom, like in the literal sense of the word. So it can't have meant domination for them. But in the modern era, post-Bacon, we start to believe that we can dominate. Yeah, but that was an inaccessible meaning of that text to ancient people. Other thoughts? Maybe completely different lines of thought. I don't know.
What have you found, has been, as you've been teaching and working with pastors and churches and stuff like that, what has been helpful for your average church member who works out somewhere, and
right.
in getting them to make this shift in their thinking that, okay, I'm here to serve the Lord, I'm here as an ambassador, a minister for him, whether that's working at Culver's or at the gas station or at the doctor's office or whatever the case may be.
Yeah. Well, I think it depends a little bit. And one thing it depends on is whether people feel they have actually authority in their job or their work. And I think a lot of people, including people you might not expect, people who we might think have a lot of authority, sometimes don't feel like they do. And so they feel like, well, but I'm sort of stuck. Like, I can't really live this out because my boss or my investors or my, you know, the owners of my company or whatever constrain me. And so the pushback, I think, is people think, I just can't, I don't have enough degrees of freedom to be able to live this out. And I think that's part of the appeal of, well, so I'm not very satisfied in my work, but I can volunteer and be in a maybe a more healthy setting sometimes where I can really live out this kind of balanced and full life. So a big problem is people just don't feel like they have what psychologists would call agency. They just don't feel empowered. I don't know, there's rarely a one-size-fits-all answer to that. You sort of have to talk with people and say, well, are there any areas in your workplace where you can pursue authority and vulnerability at the same time? And usually there are. I mean, in a sense, anyone who's not literally a slave has some degree of freedom in their work that they can use to live in a Christ-like way and in an image-restoring way. But you also have to give people permission to say, my work is full of idols and injustice. And just giving people that language, I think, really helps. And people are very able to say, oh yeah, I know who plays God in my workplace and who seeks authority without vulnerability, and I see what that does to the rest of the team. So I find giving people that language helps. Yeah.
Bill has said that next month's meeting will talk about power groups and yes. Power people. I think some people in church feel like they are powerless.
Yes.
In every other area of their lives.
Yes.
And so the church is the last place they feel like they can exercise some power.
Totally. Totally.
But there is incredible power in vulnerability. So if you grab the Puritan idea that any work is God-honoring work, in the absolutely worst job situation, a Christ follower who responds with vulnerability in the midst of a machine-driven culture, you know, an assembly line worker, tone of voice, body posture, engagement, sensitive, all the qualities that Jesus demonstrated on a boat, on a field, in the temple.
Yep.
Totally. And I think part of the rubber meets the road.
And one way I would connect those two observations is if we did a better job in the church of helping people see how they are empowered, even if their workplace is not the best environment, actually it would take the pressure off all of that pent-up desire for agency that gets channeled into conflicts in the church. And if people had more of a sense, no, actually, everywhere I go, I've got some opportunity to represent Christ, and I'm being helped to grow in that, we might find, I mean, I'm not pretending that's going to solve all of our problems, but we might find it takes away that sense that the church is the only place where people will listen, where I can exercise some control or power. Yeah.
I thought that was a beautiful illustration this morning that just has to do with perspective
yes.
in terms of what we're doing. One of the ladies who was there meets kids when they get on a bus at school.
Yeah.
You know, and her from her perspective, she's helping provide structure. She gets kids in the line. You know, she helps them get safely across the street. You know, she greets them personally and expresses love to them. I mean, she was kind of a self-empowering ministry, even though nobody else in the world included that in her job description.
Right.
But
exactly.
She saw that she was making a difference in other people's lives just by the perspective of how she saw what she was doing, which many would consider totally mundane.
Right, exactly. Right, exactly. Not a high status job, not a highly paid job, but she's found a way to make it an image-bearing job and in a way that has real impact on those kids. Yeah. Yeah, totally.
So what would you suggest as far as our approach to increase bringing the knowledge and the perspective of, you know, work and faith?
Yeah.
With more within the pulpit, you know, I think around the room we've had series on work and faith there and that, but, you know, on a regular basis.
So one of the things I've thought about is, in a very broad sense, we get what we practice. We become what we practice, and the way we practice in church, we've often used, some church traditions have used the word liturgy, not every church thinks of itself as having a liturgy, but every church has things they do over and over that they practice. And wouldn't it be amazing if we started practicing recognizing the vocational callings of people in our church? Back when that book I mentioned, Church on Sunday, Work on Monday, came out, I was talking with one of the authors, and he told me a story which is not in the book, but it's such a telling story. There's a church in Boston where the authors lived, where there was a woman who was a lawyer who worked for the Environmental Protection Agency, the federal agency, and had litigated the cleanup of Boston Harbor. So I don't know if those of you my age or older remember Boston, if you know, it used to be just completely unsafe, totally polluted. Now people swim in Boston Harbor. I flew into Boston a few weeks ago and I saw people like swimming at this little beach south of the airport. I was like, oh my gosh, I can't believe they're swimming there, because when I was growing up, you would never swim in Boston Harbor. Well, this woman was the person who led the lawsuit that led to the cleanup. I think it was Scotty, was talking to this pastor, and he said, I realized we have celebrated that woman many times in our church because she also volunteers to teach second grade Sunday school. And he said, so every year for several years, we have her come up to the front along with the other Sunday school teachers, and we pray for her and celebrate her volunteering. He said, we've never celebrated the fact that she engaged in this kind of colossal act of stewardship, of dominion, proper dominion over the environment. So it's not that you don't want to celebrate the fact that she volunteers. It's pretty amazing a lawyer like that would volunteer. That's awesome. But how about building in liturgies that on a regular basis pray for people, commission people, lay hands on people for different areas of work, And what about, if that happened every month, for a few years, people would start to get the message, we celebrate the work we do rather than just the volunteering we do inside the church. That's one super practical thing.
Well, something that I have done is, I did a 50-day adventure years ago with David Maines. It was to welcome Christ to your workplace, and I ate 50 lunches with 50 members of the church in their workplace.
Wow.
Did everything we could not to have them introduce me as their pastor. So I could experience what their workplace was like, see their space, who they work with, the temperature, the lighting, the environment.
Wow.
And I will never complain about working in the church again. I mean, it was so eye-opening to me to go into just a variety of places.
That's fantastic.
So was that a preaching series then or something?
It was actually David Maines used to produce these 50-day adventures that led up to Easter. And one was 50 days to welcome Christ to your daily work. And there was a daily journal, sermon series. But one of the things was, he said, have all your staff members eat lunch every day with someone.
Wow.
And a lot of times it was brown bag, and it was in where they actually worked. On the assembly line, it was eye-opening. And then to talk about, how do you try to reflect Christ? Or where is Christ challenged in your life in your daily job?
Yeah.
I think that picture of commissioning is just a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
How we'll have missionaries up front, commission them out.
Yes, exactly.
Or we just transition this staff person to church planting, commissioning them out and just raising up that value of, hey, we're gonna commission you out into the workplace this week because you are on mission. Boy, if we approach our work differently than the world around us, that is noticed.
Yes, absolutely.
It's noticed.
And isn't it kind of odd in a way? I don't think there's any doubt, it is harder to be a representative for Christ in a secular work environment than when you're on a mission trip or even long-term missionary service. Like, when you go on a mission trip, there are all these structures you're literally given spiritual disciplines to support you. You've got a group of people praying for you. You're going in the name of Jesus, which creates certain expectations. I mean, it can be hard, but here we have people every day trying to go out and be faithful in the workplace, where they're given no spiritual disciplines, no extra prayer support, where there's no expectation that they will behave differently. Like, actually, we should be praying for those people. And figure, oh my gosh, if you're going on a mission trip, you're going to be praying so hard already as you get on that plane or get in that car to that, urban neighborhood or whatever. You don't need our extra prayers. Like, it's almost like we should flip it. I mean, I don't necessarily mean stop commissioning your short-term mission teams, but it might be kind of a powerful symbol to say, ah, we're not going to commission you. You're doing something very faithful. We will pray for you. But the people we're going to commission are the folks meeting the kids at the bus, because that's hard work, and nobody seems to care whether you do that in a Christ-like way or not.
I know Bryce and I were talking a little bit about Larry Osborne's new book. Was it The Babylon?
Yeah. And Thriving in Babylon.
I've heard about that.
Daniel's piece of his position under Nebuchadnezzar and how many changes and pieces, but yet he lived in a way that honored God, but yet lived in a way that honored the king.
Yes.
And he thrived in that and was moved up through the ranks, right, but yet still honored God and how he approached, just that little picture of how he approached work in the secular environment.
And another great thing about Daniel, so one thing that I hope doesn't happen in the faith and work movement is a kind of overcorrection, where we've been so primed to sort of see the negative sides of work that we now just talk about work as, well, it's about image bearing and flourishing. Well, a lot of work, all work in a way, is infested with idolatry and injustice. And Daniel, of course, was intrinsically aware of that. And I think we have to keep giving people language like, no, your workplace is not the way it's meant to be, here's why, but you are there as an image restorer. So we don't stop at it's broken. We go to, you know, the call of the people of God is to be in those places and not cooperate when the king calls for the worship of the idol, whatever that looks like in your workplace. We're not asking you to do that. But you're there to actually restore the image in some way.
Yeah. Add on to that. What he said was, so often we expect non-Christians to act like Christians.
Yes, exactly.
And that's so helpful, because we can't expect people to be thinking this way and have it perfect. So his practical approach was to live in Babylon with humility, with hope, because we do have hope, and with wisdom. And I think some of the things you're talking about is the wisdom that helps us live and work to the glory of God.
So maybe I'll offer one last thought, and I have one suggestion. Do we have like 5 more minutes-ish?
Yep.
So just one last observation about this. I think one thing that's happened, one reason we've had trouble with this is actually, this is going to sound odd. At least some of you might think this sounds odd. I think we've tried to fit all of work into the gospel and make it all somehow connect to the gospel. And most work does not connect to the gospel, because it connects to something deeper than the gospel, which is God's original Genesis 1 and 2 intention for human beings. The gospel is about the restoration of the image. And some of our work can do that, but much work, I think it's wrong to try to shoehorn it into the image restoring category. A lot of what people do every day, changing diapers, greeting middle school kids, mowing lawns, is just fulfilling Genesis 1:26. And when we try to make it all fit into the specifically Christian mission, which is to tell the story of how God is restoring his image in the world, and we make it about that instead of just about image bearing, we're sort of shoehorning it in to something that doesn't really fit. And so realizing the church, if we don't proclaim the gospel, which is about how the true image bearer came, bore our sins, bore the fruit of idolatry and injustice, and now rescues us, we're not doing anything worth doing. But not all work has to fit in that frame. And that's a real paradigm shift, I think, especially for evangelical Protestants of my kind of tribe.
I heard someone say once that sometimes we act as if the Bible starts at Genesis 3.
Exactly.
And it doesn't.
Exactly. So you've got two missing chapters on each end. We have a Genesis 3 to Revelation 20 Bible. So fall to lake of fire, right? Which is a bad news to bad news Bible, by the way. And then instead of Genesis 1 and 2, which is the good news about how the way the world was made, and Revelation 21 and 22, which is about all work being rescued, restored, and redeemed. So what I always like to do at the ends of things like this, I've been talking a lot, you all have had some great comments, but I wonder if we could just each of us turn to one neighbor, like by pairs, and just, what's one thing you might take away from today? An insight, something you'd like to do differently, something you thought about in a new way? It's just to have a chance to reflect with our neighbor about what you heard. Go ahead.